Give me Psalms 82 and 6.
Psalms chapter 82 and verse 6. I have said, ye are gods.
I have said, ye are gods. Sister said, that brother is no good. He's lazy, unreliable. He broke. He ain't good looking. But guess what, sisters?
He's God. He's God. He's God!
That's right!
Well, let's look at that first. That's what we want. Now, this, put the link. Now, I really like this, and I hope that this can inspire us, and I'm sure it will. Did you put this up too, Ruben? This article? Thank you. Black neighborhood unites to open a grocery store. Now, this is profound. I love this thing. This is in North Carolina. A North Carolina neighborhood has come together to open their very own grocery store after 15 years of being without one. So for 15 years, if you want to go to the store, you had to travel outside of your area to go to the store. Much of Northeast Greensboro, North Carolina, used to buy their groceries from a local Winn-Dixie. But in 1998, despite being profitable, the store in the primarily black and lower income community, I mean poor white trash lived there too, closed down due to the company repositioning itself across the Southeast, according to Yes Magazine. The city of Greensboro attempted to listen to the demands of its citizens and find another grocery store willing to open in the area, but to no avail. So black folks went out looking for somebody, Mr. White Man, can you open a store in our community? The white man said, no. So as a result, residents figured they would have to take matters into their own hands. I love this thing. If they wanted a reliable source of food, period. In 2012, community members and leaders gathered to form the Renaissance Co-op Committee, RCC. The RCC dedicated themselves to learning the ins and outs of opening and maintaining a cooperative grocery store. So, meaning what? They took what? It starts with a C. Who said it? Counsel. They sought counsel. They sought counsel. How to do it. They were not familiar with or had the understanding of or the necessary knowledge of how to open up a grocery store, the ins and outs of it, what you need to do to succeed. Okay, where am I at, Abiel? Okay, RCC. The RCC dedicated themselves to learning the ins and outs of opening and maintaining a cooperative grocery store according to the store's webpage. In 2013, the RCC elected its board of directors for what would become the Renaissance Community Co-op, including a black president. All right, so now let's go down to the video. Does that video play right there? Okay, put the link up for them online. So black folks got together with poor white trash and was able to do something. Now, this is just to inspire us as we come into this truth to do greater and better things. Come on.
I want
a grocery store.
I want a grocery store.
I want a grocery store in my neighborhood.
In my neighborhood.
A place where community, health, and wealth
grow with every purchase.
We want a grocery store that we own.
That we own.
We own along with our neighbors.
I need to be able to walk to my store.
I want a store I can walk to.
I want a store that offers good jobs.
And living wage.
Something that we could call our own. Something that we could be proud of.
We want.
We want.
We want a co-op.
We want a co-op.
We want a co-op.
Where the employees look forward to going to work.
I want a grocery store that doesn't pick up and leave.
But that is given back to me as I'm giving to it.
So we can decide what is sold in our neighborhood.
I want a grocery store
where the profits go back into our community.
I want a co-op that helps us raise healthy children.
That keeps my daddy healthy.
We want a store that sells food. Food.
I want vegetables.
I want vegetables.
I want ice cream.
I also want ice cream.
I love me some ice cream.
But this is something that we can own a part of. Don't you want to join us? I hope you do. And you can also say it's my store. Make it personal. Make it all about you. You can walk in with your head held high. You can walk in knowing that I've played part in this, that this is a legacy I can leave behind for my children. This is something that I can tell them forever, that we have put our mark here, that we have made this happen.
Oh, yeah.
Now, that's a good thing. That's a very, very good thing, and it definitely should inspire us. Go
ahead. You know what's powerful about that is because just from doing that, that will open up other opportunities because they're going to need trucks to bring things in. They're going to need farmers. They're going to need all kinds of suppliers to work with this store. So that's going to inspire other avenues of business. Okay, that's what you got to see when you see something like this here. Because what it will do, it will spawn ideas in other areas, and it will become a collective community type of thing. And that's how you take over the planet, so you can understand.
Exactly.
By little examples like this. I just want to make another statement concerning the commercial that we saw. Because right. I was listening to the part where they said that when he goes to work, he can come in with his head held high.
That's right.
And the reason, what's the difference between him holding his head up high when he's coming to a job that he has part ownership as opposed to going to somebody else's job? When you own something, you take pride in it. Mm-hmm. When it belongs to you, you would take stock in it. You understand? We had this, me and Deacon Asaph, we had this conversation years ago when we were talking about the reason why they speak about the black community's projects and so forth, and the reason why it's so run down is because the people don't own it. Once they begin to own it, then their mentality will change. That's what happens when you own things. When you own things, you will take stock in taking care of it, usually.
Give me Jeremiah 29, and let's start at verse 4. I want y'all to understand that we have a lot of work to do as Israel. Knowing that we're Israel and the white man is the devil, that ain't the end all. There's more work that needs to be done. Getting people's minds right, we have to set in order. Come on, Captain.
Jeremiah chapter 29 and verse 4. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, unto all that are carried away captives, whom I have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem unto Babylon.
This is during the time of Nebuchadnezzar. Go ahead.
Build ye houses and dwell in them.
Now remember, we were going to be in Babylon, ancient Babylon, for how many years, brothers? 70 years. 70. We've been here in this spiritual Babylon for almost 400 years. Watch what he says. Verse 5 again.
Build ye houses and dwell in them, and plant gardens and eat the fruit of them.
Now, I know in Texas they they're farming, right? They have a farm. Thank you. Go ahead.
Take ye wives and beget sons and daughters, and take wives for your sons, and give your daughters to husbands, that they may bear sons and daughters, that ye may be increased there and not diminished.
Any Israelite that tells you, although we've been here 400 years, do not obey what we just read, he's an idiot, and if you listen to him, you're an idiot. We ain't got to get no homes or houses, or we ain't got to do nothing. Right, coming back tomorrow. You simple as hell. Yeah, but you can get white women, right? Yeah, right. Read on.
And seek the peace of the city, whither I have caused you to be carried away captive.
When it says seek the peace of the city, that does not mean don't teach the Bible. You're still supposed to teach the truth out there, but don't be doing what? Breaking laws. That's all he's saying. Don't be robbing and stealing, raping. Don't do that. That's what Jeremiah is telling us. Read that verse again.
And seek the peace of the city, whither I have caused you to be carried away captives, and pray unto the Lord for it. For in the peace thereof shall ye have peace.
And we want peace. Now, listen. Get me Sirach 37, because it said that they consulted first before they got that grocery store. So that's something that our people hate to do. A lot of our people don't like to seek counsel. Sirach 37, let's start at verse 7.
The book of Sirach, chapter 37 and verse 7. Every counselor exalteth counsel, but there is some that counseleth for himself.
So Sirach is saying to us, be mindful when you counsel. Some people counsel for themselves, meaning they want to counsel you, but it's going to benefit them in the long run. Read on.
Beware of a counselor, and know before what need he hath, for he will counsel for himself, lest he cast a lot upon thee.
So before you counsel with somebody, know what need he has before you counsel with him. I told you a story before. Years ago, we would counsel about, is pornography wrong? Now, half the brothers on the council was in love with pornography. So those are the wrong ones to counsel with. Why? Because they liked it. Know what need he has before you counsel with him. Read on.
Verse 9. And say unto thee, thy way is good. And afterward he stand on the other side to see what shall befall thee.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Consult not with one that suspecteth thee.
Don't consult or counsel with somebody that doesn't like you. He or her has an issue with you. He suspects you of evil. Don't counsel with them. Go ahead.
And hide thy counsel from such as envy thee.
And somebody that's jealous of you or hates you, don't share your counsel with them. Go ahead.
Neither consult with a woman touching her of whom she is jealous.
You see a sister you're interested in, right? She walked through the doors. Oh, she's pretty. She looked good. But you know the sister to the right is mad jealous. She's sitting, look at her. She thinks she's cute. Now you're going to talk to that sister to ask her what she think about that new sister that walked in. You think she's going to counsel you, right? No. She's going to say she ain't S8. She did. She ain't right. She got AIDS. You might hear that.
Neither with a coward in matters of war.
Here we go in the war, and you counsel with somebody who's never been in a fight. He don't know nothing about war. What do you think, brother? Agree with your adversaries quickly and run. The hell is this? Right. We need to take out insurance, life insurance policy to go to camp. We've heard that before. We have heard that. Don't counsel with a screaming scaredy cat brother about war. You may understand that?
Yes, sir.
So you captains, be mindful. Now, everybody in here ain't mighty man. Everybody say, oh, I'm a mighty man. Yeah. But you might be mighty mouse, but you ain't mighty man. Now, some of y'all taking the test. I'm telling y'all, captains, listen good. You got some brothers who are very good with the scriptures, but they're scaredy cats. Be mindful of these spirits. Then they want to take a camp. I want to lead a camp. Are you kidding me? So you can't have a coward over at camp, brothers, or scaredy brothers in camp. Y'all got to just chill, wait, build till you build your spirit up. Where we at, Captain Isaac?
Verse 11.
Go ahead.
Nor with a merchant concerning exchange.
Right, because he going to counsel you so he get the best wages that favor him or her. Go ahead.
Nor with a buyer of selling.
Uh-huh.
Nor with an envious man of thankfulness.
Don't talk with a nigger about being thankful. He or she don't have that spirit on him. Go ahead.
Nor with an unmerciful man touching kindness.
You got a brother who don't know nothing about mercy. You want to counsel with him about mercy? It's the wrong one to do it with. Go ahead.
Nor with the slothful for any work.
You going to talk to the laziest brother in Israel about starting your own business. You're crazy. You talk with Mr. Sloth himself. Go ahead.
Nor with an hireling for a year of finishing work.
Go ahead.
Nor with an idle servant of much business. Hearken not unto these in any matter of counsel.
So the Bible tells you who not to listen to when it comes to counsel. So, yeah, go ahead.
When it says nor a hireling, I'm sorry, my glasses. Nor with a hireling for a year of finishing work. What does that mean? When it says nor with a hireling for a year of finishing work, meaning the hireling doesn't want the job to end. So he's not going to work to get it done. He's going to give you reasons why it has to continue going on and on and on. All right? Right.
Verse 12.
Come on, watch this.
But be continually with a godly man, whom thou knowest to keep the commandments of the Lord, whose mind is according to thy mind, and will sorrow with thee if thou shalt miscarry.
So Sirach says, be continually with a godly man, one who you know keeps the commandments. That's the first thing you brothers and sisters know. before you deal with counsel. Go ahead.
And let the counsel of thine own heart stand, for there is no man more faithful unto thee than it.
Come on.
For a man's mind is sometime wont to tell him more than seven watchmen that sit above in a high tower.
So that's when you are in your mind, you already have your mind set up of what you're going to do. Once you do it, do what you're going to do. Go ahead.
And above all this, pray to the Most High, that he will direct thy way in truth.
So the main thing, above all things, you want to pray to the Lord before you take part on any matter. Go ahead.
Let reason go before every enterprise, and counsel before every action.
Now that's the part I really want to get to. Read 16 again.
Let reason go before every enterprise, and counsel before every action.
Go ahead, read it again.
Let reason go before every enterprise, and counsel before every action.
So what we saw in Greensboro, North Carolina, they took counsel, they reasoned about a supermarket. Now I'm getting somewhere with this. I'm getting somewhere with it. We just read who not to counsel with in business, correct, brothers? Okay, so now we're going to get to the topic. I know I've not gotten to the topic yet, but now we get into the Godfather topic. In this truth, we need a lot of things. We have a lot of teachers. Brothers are excellent in teaching from state to state, and that's good. That's wonderful. But based upon what we read in Jeremiah 29, there are other things we need in this truth. We always, brothers, be getting in trouble. We need lawyers. How about that? We need nurses. We need teachers, because we want our children to learn from us rather than send them to the middle-class white woman or man in your school system, public schools, who are the offspring of the civil rights movement, who was pro-segregation, who hated black kids being in school with white kids. These are our teachers now, of our children. So we want to get to a point where we teach our own kids. Okay, everybody understand that? We need doctors. We need a lot of things. We need a lot of things. So it would behoove you brothers and sisters, if you're in school, continue. If brothers and sisters come in the truth, they're in school, encourage them on. Brothers, listen good. You get some sisters, you marry some sisters, they go, oh, I'm married now. Guess what's one of the first thing they do? Drop out of school. That's a no-no. That's a no-no. When a sister, I'm starting with a sister, sister decides I'm going to drop out of school, she's telling you, I want to be your ball and chain. She's not there to be a ball and chain for you, brothers. She's there to be what, brothers? No, he said that thing quick. Help me! Damn it! Bang the table! Help me! Uh-huh. Husbands and wives are the physical manifestation of Christ and the church. I'm going to say it again. Husbands and wives are the physical manifestation of Christ and the church. Give me that in Ephesians 5. That might have went over some of y'all heads. Well, what do you mean by that? Paul told you a great mystery about marriage. Some of you young men don't understand marriage. You always want to get married.
Ephesians 5 and verse 31. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother.
Shall a man leave his father and mother. Sisters, some of y'all get hooked up with some of these men, and they will not leave father or mother. They are your proverbial mama boys. And if you decide, sister, without counsel, I'm going to marry him. Shame on you. We're not going to have counsel with you every week because you, sister, are a dummy. We told you. You have been warned. He's a mama's boy. He's not ready yet. He still lives with mommy and daddy. I'm going to marry him. He looks sexy. Well, you go ahead and marry him then. We ain't counseling with you week after week because now here she come. He always put his mama first. His mama say this. He threw it in my... And I'm pregnant. Sister, you would use a dummy. We warned you in the beginning. You didn't listen to us.
Or you didn't seek counsel prior to getting with him, because there's a lot of situations... They don't come to us as fathers in this truth and ask us, what do they see? You and I'm talking about, and I don't care what age you at. Right. You come in this truth, you could be 50 years old. You came in here last week, you're a week old. Right. And you come in here, and these guys, you have your sidebar because you think you have age, and you're speaking, and you get caught up. Then after the fact, then you come to us to fix it. We can't fix it now. Too exactly. late. You're married.
You got a big baby Huey on your hands. My mama done told me. Read that again, Captain.
Ephesians 5:31. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother.
So the first thing you brothers need to understand, when you decide to get married, leave your mommy and daddy.
And shall be joined unto his wife.
And joined unto his wife.
And they too shall be one flesh.
Come on.
This is a great mystery.
Y'all hear that? Marriage is a great mystery. Go ahead.
But I speak concerning Christ and the church.
Marriage represents Christ and the church. That's what we as a people have not realized yet. We just think it's marriage. No, brother, you represent Christ in the house. The woman represents the disciple in the house. So, brothers cry, I want a wife, brother, I want a wife. Brothers cry, I want to get married, I want a wife, I want a wife, I want a wife. Not realizing the level of responsibility they're asking for. You men, when you say you want a wife, you're saying you are ready for a level of responsibility you have never seen before. And some of you brothers, you want to get married, but you don't realize your responsibility to your wife in this truth. Sisters, some brothers want to marry you, not to build a family at all. They don't want to build a family. They want, as I said, they want that sexual release. When I get that feeling, you know, that's all they want. That's all they want. Then you sisters realize that you have laid down with a black devil, a black or Latin devil. Because he ain't about nothing. He laying home scratching. That's all he do. He don't work. He don't provide nothing. All right. And then once they get that release, I'm going to tell you, sisters, the real them comes out. That's how men are. Once we
explode,
you know.
Pure.
Woo! You're going to see the real us within an hour or two. You're going to see the real us. Brothers, I'm going to tell you something. Women are not as easy as that. The real them, it takes a little while longer. They're more, right, thank you. They're more reserved before you see the real them. Brothers, see, brother, the real them going to come out with men within the first hour, within that hour after our release. Women's may take a month or two. You're going to notice a few things with some women, brothers. You're going to notice, A, they drop out of school, some of them. Some of them don't want to work. I want you to take care of me. I know we need two family income, but I want you to provide for me. I'm going to lay here. Right. They don't want to be corrected. Don't tell them nothing. You're going to hear, you ain't my daddy. We're going to talk about that in a second. Right. You are lying in your own house. Sisters, I'm going to let y'all know, some brothers in Israel are immature. Immature. They are not ready to take the position that Christ took for Israel. So these are things you have to look at. And if you sisters are not wise enough to see that, seek counsel. And we will tell you, it's us up here or some of the captains off, just talk. We'll let you know if a brother's ready yet. Oh, no, not ready yet. He's that brother right there. That's a hands-on brother. She go, oh, I like that. No, I don't mean that way. He's violent. That's what I'm talking. He got a temper. Be mindful of getting with that brother so he's able to calm his spirit down and deal with situations. Some brothers want to punch you in the mouth first and ask questions later. Go ahead.
And this is for the brothers and sisters. If you all would take full advantage of the leadership that you have here and ask these questions, you'd be surprised how much problems you can get yourself out of. There's so much stuff that we know that we don't share with people, but as counselors we do know, and we can just navigate you. But for some reason, our people, I can count on one hand with four fingers left over. How many people listen to counsel concerning marriage? That is the single biggest decision you will make in this truth, other than coming into the truth, is who you pick as a spouse. Children, they're born to you. The woman or the man you pick, you're making a conscious decision, at least it should be conscious decision, a spiritual decision on who you choose to align yourself with for the rest of your life. And I've seen so many times people screw up at this because they're led by their rod or whatever it else is, and then after the fact, they got problems, and there's no fixing it unless somebody dies. Okay.
Get Tobit 8 and 6. Tobit 8 and 6. Right, you can't kill him either. Can't kill him. Marriage is an institution that is foreign to blacks and Latinos. It's very foreign to them. What's that? I can't spell marriage. Yeah, right. Tobit 8, verse 6, Captain.
The book of Tobit, chapter 8 and verse 6. Thou madest Adam and gavest him Eve, his wife, for an helper and stay.
So what was Eve's purpose? What was she? A helper and stay. A keyword, helper. Helper, not ball and chain. Helper. I hope you women understand that. I want to get married. I'm just going to lay around the house. No, you're supposed to be a helper and stay. Yes, can we look it up? Can we look up that word helper?
I looked in my thing, and the helper was real plain, but then it tells you help. So help says, to give or provide what is necessary to accomplish a task or satisfy a need. Contribute strength or means to. Render assistance to. Cooperate effectively.
Mm.
Cooperate effectively. With aid, assist.
Did that say argue?
It cooperate effectively.
Y'all hear that? I hope you women hear that. Cooperate effectively.
Do we got to look up cooperate?
Yeah, I hope not. I hope not. I hope y'all effective. Know what that means. Yeah, just in case. You know, some people like to play stupid. Cooperate. I don't know what it means. Act jointly. Work toward the same end. That's what it means. Not fight against the disciples when it's not going against Christ. Yes. I can't see where. Oh, assist someone or comply with their requests.
Can I read one? Let me read one. To work or act with another or other persons willingly.
And
agreeably.
Exactly. So we read in Tobit, she's to be a helper and stay, a pillar of rest. Watch this. Give me Tobit 2. Tobit chapter 2, verse 11 and 12. When Tobit got blind, his wife showed him, proved to him. She said, I got your back, baby. I got your back. Watch what she did. He couldn't work no more. Tobit couldn't work. He was blind 8 years. Come on.
Tobit chapter 2 and verse 11. And my wife Anna did take woman's work.
My wife Anna did take woman's work. Go ahead.
To do. And when she had sent them home to the owners, they paid her wages.
So because Tobit was blind, his wife went out and got woman's work. She said, don't worry. We are not going to be broke. I got what? Give me the word she had. Job. Oh, how about this? Skills. So sis, if you know, when y'all get, sisters talk to brothers, brothers talk to sisters, there's nothing wrong with saying, do you have a job? That's number one. And brothers, don't get mad. You should not get mad if a woman asks you, do you have a job? In the world, brothers, we're getting mad. What you ask me that for? Because why? All we want is sex and now get out. Ask me if I got a job for. Now here's the turnaround. Today's brother is asking sisters, does she got a job? You know why brothers ask sisters that? Because he want to lay around and scratch. That's pimp 101, pimpology 101. Now, did you read that? What verse you read down to?
Verse 12.
You read down to 12?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I didn't finish it yet.
Go ahead, finish it. Come on.
And when she had sent them home to the owners, they paid her wages and gave her also besides a kid. And when it was in my house and began to cry, I said unto her, from whence is this kid? Is it not stolen?
Right. So he knew how much a kid, which is either a baby lamb or goat, it costs a lot. He said, this is more than your wages. Where did this come from? Go ahead.
Render it to the owners.
Tobit thought she stole it, but she said what? Go ahead.
For it is not lawful to eat anything that is stolen. But she replied upon me.
Notice it says she replied upon him. Not to him, upon him. Meaning there was an argument there about this little animal. Go ahead.
It was given for a gift.
I got this as a gift, my lord. Go ahead.
More than the wages. Howbeit, I did not believe her.
He didn't believe her. Letting you know, all the marriages in the Bible were not perfect. But because they weren't perfect, they didn't say what? I'm leaving you because we argue. Go ahead.
Howbeit, I did not believe her, but bade her render it to the owners, and I was abashed at her. But she replied upon me, Where are thine alms and thy righteous deeds? Behold, though thou and all thy works are known.
She got the gift because of Tobit's good works. That's why the people that worked, that she worked for, gave her that gift, because of her husband's works. So now, right, he was well known in the gates. Thank you. Some sisters don't realize their role in this truth. I know I'm talking about godfathers, but they over there going, why are you talking about the women again? How? I thought the name of the class was godfathers. Some sisters don't realize their role in this truth is to be a helper, a helper.
Titus chapter 2 and verse 3. The aged woman likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, that they may teach the young woman to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands.
So that has to be taught. Some of you brothers, you're in such a rush. Such a rush! You know who you are. You know, brothers know who you are because you're complaining now about the woman you just married. The house is filthy. She don't know how to wash clothes. She don't know how to clean. She don't know how to cook. Now you're a brother. You didn't figure that out before when y'all were talking one with another? No, because you was looking in her eyes. She's looking in your eyes. No, brothers don't look in sisters' eyes. Where do we look? But now you pay. Now you're paying the price. You realize that she can't cook. She can't clean. She can't do nothing. And she's eating all the food you bring from the Chinese restaurant. All that food, she's just sitting around eating, and she's getting wider and wider. Now she looks like a linebacker.
Damn.
Give me Sirach 26:16.
But I want to say something. The only reason why that's happening, and in every marriage, there's going to be trouble. But the scriptures are here for us to learn from to how to fix it, how to make it work. But it's happening because you men tolerate that stuff in your house. You tolerate it. You have, and many times you tolerate because you're afraid to say something or afraid to put your foot down. You have to demand, like with Christ, like with the Most High. Most High is demanding what he wants from his son. Christ is demanding what he wants from us. We have to demand. We have to be godly men, first and foremost. I'm not talking about a niggard man that beat or verbally abused, whatever it might be. They're women. But we have to set, when the scripture says, he gives the wife beginneth possession, meaning you're building towards something. And her being a helpmeet, she has to fall in line with your program. Mm-hmm. So if you're a man, and I saw one of the deacons made a comment on Glide, if you're out there providing for your household, why we have to explain why we eat first? Right. If you're out there providing for your household, why you got to come home and do dishes? Mm-hmm. You got to be out your mind. I'll do dishes if I want to do dishes, and I don't want to do it.
Exactly.
I don't want to do it. But when a gunman come through that door, I'll be the first one out the bed. Mm-hmm. If you're obedient to me.
Where we at, Isaac?
Sirach, chapter 26.
Verse 16.
Verse 16. As the sun when it ariseth in the high heaven, so is the beauty of a good wife in the ordering of her house.
The ordering of a house, that's what I'll tell you. I went over, when I was in Texas, I was at Deacon Shaka's house. The first thing I said as soon as I sat down, I said, Deacon, this is a lovely place, and I know sure as hell you didn't decorate this place. You can always tell when brothers come to my house, you know I didn't decorate that thing. I have stains on the wall, all kind of stuff, but it's the woman's job in the ordering of the house. She makes it look nice. Now, some of you brothers, you young ones, particularly you hooked up with a sister, she don't know how to decorate nothing. She don't know how to paint. She don't know how to do nothing. We need Barnabas to come over and fix everything up. Barnabas, can you do this for me? This woman don't know how to do nothing, and I'm at work. So you got to be mindful, very mindful.
And with the women, and we understand it, and we're coming out of generations, especially the women, that you might not have mothers that did it, but you have to have a willing spirit wanting to learn. You have to want to learn, and that's why you have the elder sisters to go to so you can learn from that. Also with you men are learning how to be men. You have to come for counsel to learn how to fix it. All these scriptures we're going over is that we can fix the black family, that we can work together.
That's right.
All right?
Exactly. So now, sister's sitting there going, but my man is no good. He's no good. He's shiftless. He don't work. He don't even compliment me on nothing. That's the woman, one of the big things. He don't compliment me. Sister said that brother is no good. He's lazy, unreliable. He broke. He ain't good looking. But guess what, sisters?
He's God.
That's right.
Hey, all the brothers ain't clap, Abigail. They don't understand what's going on. Let me say it again. He's God.
That's right.
Sisters ain't clapping at that. Look at that. Mm-hmm. All right, okay, all praise. Some of them clapping. Some of them clapping. All praise. They have redeemed themselves. Some of them sitting here like an ostrich going, mm-hmm. Read me that scripture. Some of them online going, what do you mean he's God? Yeah, only one God. Give me Psalms 82 and 6.
Psalms chapter 82 and verse 6. I have said, ye are gods.
I have said, ye are gods. Go ahead.
And all of you are children of the Most High.
And all of you are children of the Most High. Go ahead.
But ye shall die like men.
But you shall die like men. That means we went into slavery. We lost our power. We lost our authority. We lost everything, sister. We lost everything. Even in slavery, the white man made sure we didn't have a leg to stand on. We get married, they would take our wife and send her to the next county to get another man. That's what happened. Then they introduced welfare. They said, okay, we're going to pay for your food, clothing, water, shelter, but you cannot have a man figure in the house. Some women said, okay, I want that. And you know what? The women that complained about the man ain't no good is the same ones who would be on the public assistance, have the welfare, who have accepted the white man's financial handicap to your life, and then complain. Well, sister, wait a minute. Did you accept the public assistance where there could be no man? Yes. So why are you now in the same voice, you're saying a man is no good, he ain't home? He can't be home. What's wrong with you? Are you crazy? Read that again.
But ye shall die like men.
But men, we have died like men. Gods, we have died like men. Notice there's an S on that word, gods. It's talking about the men of the Most High, his sons. Let's go New Testament now. Get me Romans 8:19. Brothers, listen good. Sisters, listen good to this thing here.
The book of Romans, chapter 8 and verse 19. For the earnest expectation of the creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of God.
Sisters, I want y'all to understand something about that no good, lazy, shiftless, unreliable black man or Latin man. Everybody's waiting for his manifestation of the sons of God. The entire planet Earth is waiting for him to take his rightful place. And sister, you're going to get your glory only when he gets his glory. Your glory is to support him. When you support him and he gets into that throne, you're going to get your honor, your praise. All that you look for, you shall have. But if you are a scorpion, always biting him, stinging him, oh, you're going to get something all right. Get me Ezekiel 34, 31. Sisters always complain. Some sisters complain. There's the Bible written in the masculine form. Some scriptures ain't written in masculine. We're going to read them tonight too.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 34, verse 31. And ye, my flock, the flock of my pastor, are men.
That's right. Everybody need to understand that thing. God says the flock of my pastor are men, not women. Men. So, sister, he might be no good, unreliable, shiftless, but that's why he's here, to get his mind right. He might not be marriage material yet, but give him time. We're working with him. We're trying to build him up. And when he's ready for you, we're going to say, all right, sister, he's ready for you. Take your king. Take your Lord. And it's a beautiful thing when you follow it in that order. Give me Proverbs 8 and 4.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 8 and verse 4. Unto you, O men, I call, and my voice is to the sons of men.
Y'all see that thing? That thing is beautiful. And my voice is to the sons of men. Does that mean that God doesn't deal with women, brother? No, it don't mean that, but there is an order. And man is first, numero uno, primo. Understand that. It's never the other way around. Now, here we go. Isaiah 13:12, brothers, you are the God fathers. You are. And this class is going to big you up. We're going to strengthen you. We're going to help you. And if the sisters are in the right frame of mind, she's going to do the same thing.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 13 and verse 12. I will make a man more precious than fine gold.
Y'all see that? Go ahead.
Even a man than the golden wedge of Ophir.
I will make a man. Because right now, man, we ain't nothing in society. Last hired, first fired. Women get the better jobs. They're put in positions of authority over the man. That's all right. That's okay. Understand. There's examples in the Bible. There was an example in the scriptures of a sister who was made head over an entire empire. Okay, give me the book of Esther. Sisters. Listen good. You might, when you leave home, sisters, some of y'all in here got good jobs. I know. Sisters online, we get emails all the time. They got good jobs. Very good jobs, and they make very good money. You want to get with a man who understands that, but more importantly, sister, you want to understand your role. Because some women think, I make more cheddar than you. I'm better than you. I'm running things up in here. I run the house. I wear the pants in the house. Let's see if Esther said that thing.
Esther, chapter 9, verse 29. Then Esther the queen, the daughter of Abihail, and Mordecai the Jew, wrote with all authority to confirm the second letter of Purim.
So when you read this history, Esther used her authority to benefit who? Israel. She didn't forget. I mean, she did forget. Mordecai had to put her back in the right frame of mind. But when she got back in her right frame of mind, she used her authority over the entire Persian Empire to save her people, Israel. That's what she did. That's what women have to have in their mind. They have a position of authority. Okay, let me use this to help my people. Let me use the monies I make to support my nation, my people, my family, my husband. Give me 1 Corinthians 11 and 3 now. So now, sister, you understand as a helper and stay, you have to use your power, your authority, your know-how to support your nation of Israel, support your family, support your husband. That's your job when you have that authority in the world. And men, if you marry a sister who has authority in this world, don't pull her down. Don't try to destroy her. Come on.
1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 3. But I would have you know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of the woman is the man.
That's what the Lord is looking for. He's only looking for women that acknowledge that thing. When a woman has an attitude and does not acknowledge it, the Lord can't use her. Mm-mm. She's in that Christian 50-50, my way or the highway frame of mind. God cannot use her. Maybe in the evil sense he can, but not in righteousness, because her mind ain't right. Now, give me Galatians 3, because here's the Christian woman's ammunition. Against all the scriptures we read, the Christian woman will run here. Galatians 3, 28, 29.
The book of Galatians, chapter 3 and verse 28. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female. For ye are all one in Christ Jesus. And if ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise.
So the subject of verse 28 and 29 is being Abraham's seed and heirs. What's that next word? Heirs of what?
According to the promise.
According to the promise. So, when Paul says there's neither Jew nor Greek, it's in keeping it in context, he's talking about being an heir to promise, correct? So, being an heir, when he says there's neither Jew nor Greek, who can explain that part right there? There's neither Jew nor Greek. One, two hands, three hands. Let me hear Reuben. I haven't heard you tonight.
The history between Israel and the Greeks is 2 Maccabees 6 and 6 through 9.
Uh-huh.
When Ptolemy said, you know, Israel, you cannot keep the custom of the Israelites. You have to be converted to be a Greek. So when Paul was saying that, he was saying, you know, the Israelites that were scattered abroad who were Greek, they were keeping the Greekish laws, not the Israelites' laws. I mean, they were calling themselves Greeks or whatever they were.
So in essence, when he says it's neither Jew nor Greek, meaning all Israel is going to inherit the be heirs of the promise. Everybody understand that? So now, it said there's neither Jew nor Greek, bond nor free. What's that part? Bond nor free. Bond nor free. Bond nor free. This young man right here, Jezreel, you said your name was? Okay. Bond nor free.
Meaning slave or free. Slave or no slave.
Okay. Get me the scripture, I believe it's in Acts, it might be 21, 22, where they ask Paul, how did you get this, Paul, how did you get this freedom? I want that one. Acts 22 in what verse? 28. Okay.
The book of Acts, chapter 22 and verse 28. And the chief captain answered with a great sum.
Start above it.
Verse 27. Then the chief captain came and said unto him, tell me, art thou a Roman? He said, yea. And the chief captain answered.
Stop. Paul had Roman citizenship. Roman citizenship gave you, what's that, Blanche? What is that? Carte blanche. To be a Roman citizen, you were over all the other nations when you had that Roman citizenship. You were not under the same rules as the, as the regular Joe under Rome. The commoners, thank you, I like that word. Go ahead.
And the chief captain answered, with a great sum obtained I this freedom.
With a great sum obtained I this freedom. What freedom? To be a Roman citizen. To become a Roman citizen, you could travel where you wanted to go. Like, that's why when, a lot of y'all understand. Peter and them did not have the liberty of traveling to all these different places. Paul did. He was a Roman citizen. He could go here, he could go there. He wasn't questioned the same way they were questioned. Where are you going? What's in your bag? Let me see it. He wasn't always stopped at roadblocks, things of that nature. Okay? So there was a freedom that came with being a Roman citizen. So when we go back to Galatians 3:28, and it talked about there's neither bond nor free, meaning we're all the same, whether or not you are a servant or you're freeborn. Paul was saying we're all, as Israel, we all get the inheritance of promise. Now the question comes in the next part of Galatians where it says there's neither male nor female. What's that? Because Christians use it to say, that means men and women are equal. Equal in the context, they're right in that sense, but an equal in context of what? In being an heir of the promise. You may understand that? Being an heir to the promise that was given to our forefathers. There's equality there because the husband could be the devil, the woman gonna get saved if she's not, or vice versa. You understand that? We're heirs together, okay? So now. Galatians 3:20 means we're all heirs. It does not mean there is no order. The Most High loves order, even when it comes to the nation of Israel. Uh-oh, people gonna get mad now. Lob are gonna get mad, look at his face. God loves order. Give me that, in Genesis 49 and 8. But we're all heirs together. That's why it says there's neither Jew nor Greek. When it comes to being an heir of promise, that's true. There's no difference between the kingdom of Judah and the kingdom of Israel, which was Ephraim and the other 10.
The book of Genesis.
But watch this.
Chapter 49 and verse 8.
Get mad.
Judah, thou art he whom thy brethren shall praise.
Get mad now.
Thy hand shall be in the neck of thine enemy.
The Most High said, Judah, or he looked at all the 12 tribes and said, Judah, you're the one thy brethren shall praise. Let's see why. It says your hand shall be in the neck of thine enemy. Why? Give me Zechariah 12 and 7. The Most High is about order. Now, I want you to understand, just because you're Judah, don't mean that you're part of the 144. Some Judah is level 3 retarded. I'm going to tell you straight, some Judah ain't right. You got that?
I'm getting it.
Zechariah 12 and 7.
Zechariah 12 and verse 7. The Lord also shall save the tents of Judah first, that the glory of the house of David and the glory of the inhabitants of Jerusalem do not magnify themselves against Judah.
So the Most High said, I'm going to raise Judah first. They're going to be the teachers. They're going to be the ones in the forefront of this thing. That's how the Most High set it up. Okay? Now, when it comes to the lands of Israel, there's order. Of all the allotments of land, get me that in Psalms 87, Benjamin's favorite scripture. Psalms 87, 1 to 3.
The book of Psalms, chapter 87 and verse 1. His foundation is in the holy mountain.
That's the land of Israel. Come on.
The Lord loveth the gates of Zion more than all the dwellings of Jacob.
The gates of Zion is Jerusalem. He says, I love Jerusalem more than all the lands of Israel. Go ahead.
Glorious things are spoken of thee, O city of God, Selah.
O city of God, Selah, meaning all praises to the Lord. That's what that, it does not mean Selah, don't mean Haile Selassie. It don't mean that. Hell is going on here. So now, I got to get back to the man. I got to get back to the Godfather topic. Let me go back. Sisters, your man, we have read that he is God on the earth. That don't mean he's the Most High. It don't mean he's Christ. But he is under that, give me the word. He's under that title right there. Watch this. Watch this, Numbers 30 and 1. Come on.
The book of Numbers, chapter 30 and verse 1.
Let's show you the man's God-like authority.
And Moses spake unto the heads of the tribes concerning the children of Israel, saying, this is the thing which the Lord hath commanded. If a man vow a vow unto the Lord, or swear an oath to bind his soul with a bond, he shall not break his word. He shall do according to all that proceedeth out of his mouth.
So now, Moses reminded you Israelite men, whatever you say you're going to do, do it before the Lord. But now he says, he addresses the woman. Watch.
If a woman also vow a vow unto the Lord and bind herself by a bond, being in her father's house in her youth.
Being in her father's house in her youth. She's a daughter. Go ahead.
And her father hear her vow, and her bond wherewith she hath bound her soul, and her father shall hold his peace at her. Then all her vows shall stand. And every bond wherewith she hath bound her soul shall stand.
So the vowing went into, she goes before the Lord to send her prayers. She's praying to the Lord verbally. The Father can hear her. Whatever she's asking the Most High for, wants him to do for her, if he doesn't interject everything that the daughter has prayed for, the Most High said, because the Father did not intervene, she shall bind herself with what she says. Read.
But if her father disallow her, in the day that he heareth.
Meaning he hears the daughter say something stupid in that prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, I want to marry Denzel Washington. Make me his wife. No, stop. That's stupid. Don't pray for that. Go ahead.
Not any of her vows or of her bonds wherewith she hath bound her soul shall stand. And the Lord shall forgive her because her father disallowed her.
So the father has power for the Lord to go before the Lord and say, Lord, do not listen to her prayer. That was stupid. Forgive her, Father. Go ahead.
And if she had at all in husband.
Now, this is for you married sisters who complain about your man being no good, shiftless, unreliable, a bum. Go ahead.
When she vowed or uttered out of her lips, wherewith she bound her soul, and her husband heard it, and held his peace at her in the day that he heard it, then her vow shall stand, and her bonds wherewith she bound her soul shall stand.
Go ahead.
But, if her husband disallowed her.
Meaning, Lord, don't listen to this simple wife of mine. That was stupid. Don't honor that prayer which she just vowed. Do not honor that. Go ahead.
On the day that he heard it, then he shall make her vow which she vowed, and that which she uttered with her lips, wherewith she bound her soul, of none effect.
Of what effect?
Of none effect.
Now that's some power you brothers didn't know you had. Some of the women didn't know. He got, authority to do that? Yes. He is God. I'm telling you. So if you pray something stupid, brothers, just lift it. Lord, don't listen to that prayer. That was stupid. That was a feminist movement. Do not listen. God kill him. I'm mad at him. He didn't wash the dishes like I asked him to do. Lord, don't listen to nothing she's saying. Go ahead.
And the Lord shall forgive her. But every vow, it goes into the widow now.
Yeah, I want it.
But every vow of a widow and of her that is divorced.
This is for the woman who is a widow. She don't have a husband, and she that is divorced don't have a husband.
Wherewith they have bound their souls shall stand against her. And if she vowed in her husband's house or bound her soul by a bound.
So the widow or the divorced woman, whatever she prays, it's going to stand. Most of us, okay, there's no man there to shut it down. It's going to stand. As stupid as it is, it's going to stand. Go ahead.
And her husband heard it and held his peace at her and disallowed her not. Then all her vows shall stand, and every bond wherewith she bound her soul shall stand. But if her husband hath utterly made them void on the day he heard them, then whatsoever proceeded out of her lips concerning her vows or concerning the bond of her soul shall not stand.
Shall not stand. Go ahead.
Her husband hath made them void.
Her husband hath made them. This is some powerful stuff here, brothers. Go ahead.
And the Lord shall forgive
and
her.
And the Lord shall forgive her. Come on.
Every vow and every binding oath to afflict the soul, her husband may establish
her it. Her husband may establish it. Go ahead.
Or her husband may make it void.
Or her husband may shut it down. Go ahead.
But if her husband altogether hold his peace at her from day to day, then he establisheth all her vows, or all her bonds, which are upon her. He confirmeth them, because he held his peace at her in the day that he heard them.
Be mindful, you scaredy brothers. You hear the woman say something stupid, and you don't want to say nothing because she might yell at you. You simple as hell. You bound yourself to that stupidity too. Go ahead.
But if he shall anyways make them void after that he hath heard them, then he shall bear her iniquity.
You're going to bear the iniquity. If she prayed something evil and stupid, it might be your own death. God kill him. And you don't say nothing. Okay, go ahead.
These are the statutes which the Lord commanded Moses between a man and his wife, between the father and his daughter, being yet in her youth in her father's house.
So now, does that mean God does not deal with the woman? No, it does not mean that. Now, sisters, when we read this, some sisters read about how the Lord used certain women, and they use those scriptures to mean, I am superior to the man. It goes, the ranking system is God, Christ, woman, then man. They're insane. I am right. Now, you mentioned the word prophetess. Brothers, listen. If a sister has to tell you she's a prophetess, chances are she's the devil the Bible speaks of. Because guess what? If she is a prophetess, it's going to come out. Everybody's going to acknowledge, hey, this sister such and such said this some time ago. Oh, man, the Lord was dealing with that sister. It's going to be revealed. When she has to go to you and go, I'm a prophet. She's the devil. She's Juanita Bynum. Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. Out of those three, who was the main one God was dealing with? Moses. Okay, Exodus 7 and 7. Read that.
The book of Exodus, chapter 7 and verse 7. And Moses was 80 years old, and Aaron 40.
What is 80? 80. Moses was 80 years old when God was dealing with him, when he repented. And it says, and Aaron what?
And Aaron 83 years old, when they spake unto Pharaoh.
Now here's my question. Miriam, was she younger or older than them both? She was older. When you read Exodus 2, remember she was the one that walked the baby Moses down the Nile. Remember? And it says when Pharaoh's daughter saw the baby in that basket, it was Miriam that said, do you want me to fetch a midwife for the baby? And Pharaoh's daughter said, yes. And it says Miriam went and got the mother. Miriam was way older than Moses and Aaron. I said that for a reason. Just because Miriam was older, does that mean she was in charge? No. Because what book and chapter is the proof of that? Numbers chapter 12. Numbers chapter 12. Now, in case nobody read this before, because I know a lot of you are new, we're going to read a little bit of it. Give me that, Isaac.
Yes, sir. The book of Numbers, chapter 12 and verse 6. And he said, "Hear now my words. If there be a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known unto him in a vision and will speak unto him in a dream. My servant Moses is not so, who is faithful in all mine house. With him will I speak mouth to mouth, even apparently, and not in dark speeches, and the similitude of the Lord shall he behold. Wherefore, then were ye not afraid to speak against my servant Moses?"
Because Miriam and Aaron was railing on Moses about the Ethiopian woman. Go ahead.
"And the anger of the Lord was kindled against them, and he departed. And the cloud departed from off the tabernacle. And behold, Miriam became leprous, white as snow."
So that proves that Miriam was a so-called black woman. That's number one. Number two, it shows you that the Lord ain't dealing with loud-mouthed women. When you read in Exodus, was Miriam a prophetess?
The book of Exodus, chapter 15 and verse 20. "And Miriam, the prophetess, the sister of Aaron, took a timbrel in her hand, and all the women went out after her with timbrels and with dances."
Miriam the prophetess would lead the women in song and dance. And that must have been a beautiful thing. See a whole bunch of women just singing and dancing, honoring you. Oh, I can't wait. They didn't want to sing and dance now, but you're going to sing and dance. So what Miriam was a prophetess, but she got out of order in Numbers 12, so the Most High had to smite her. So although I'm dealing with you, Miriam, whoop-pow! Now there's another one. In Acts, it said there, Philip had seven daughters. Acts 21, verse 9. I'm reading this to show you that the Lord does deal with certain sisters who stay in order, who are respectful of the order. Come on.
Acts chapter 21 and verse 9. "And the same man had four daughters, virgins, which did prophesy."
Virgins, which did prophesy. Now, there's two kinds of prophesying. One prophesying is when you're reading the scriptures, like it says in Revelation 19 about the spirit of, it says, testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. That's when you're going through the scriptures. The second kind is when you have dreams and visions of things which will come to pass in conjunction with this. So that's the second kind. So now, I'm going back. So we read all of that to show that God does deal with women. He deals with men, but there's always an order. He deals with all the tribes. There's an order. He loves all the lands of Israel, but there's an order.
Shalom, Israel. I'm Elder Nathaniel, Israel United in Christ. YouTube likes to shut our channels down, as some of you have noticed, ever so often. Subscribing to Join IUIC will assure you will always stay connected to our YouTube accounts. We want to do our best to make sure this truth gets out. Please click and join our subscriber YouTube channel called Join IUIC to stay linked to all of our videos. So again, please make sure you subscribe to this Join IUIC channel to get your latest updates on all our YouTube channels. Shalom.